as Vinay just introduced me, I'm actually a neuroscientist. I direct the Del Monte Institute for Neuroscience at the University of Rochester. But like a lot of scientists in the field of medicine for the last year plus, I've been sidetracked worrying about COVID and SARS-CoV-2 and its impact on the brain. And I just want to run you through a few slides, and sorry, I won't be able to cover a huge amount of detail, but we'll just a little bit of what we think we know about this at this point in time. I pulled these numbers yesterday, just, you know, as a health professional, it's important. We all feel the spring unwinding and the tension ebbing, and that we're at the end of what was a really brutal year. But I would remind people that we're not out of this yet. This is not over. As of yesterday, almost 600,000 Americans have perished to COVID, and that's probably, very probably, a serious underestimation. And just yesterday, there were the best part of 12,000 new cases and 421 additional deaths. So we're still losing people to the tune of about 400 people a day. Just a bit of perspective on that. That's more than World War I, the Vietnam and Korean wars combined. And yet, as a society, I think we've sort of become a little bit inured to the sort of the sheer epic scope of what's actually happened to us as a society. It was interesting when I was trying to pull together a few slides, I was pulling these numbers. It turned out that very early in the pandemic, I gave pretty much the same kind of lecture. And this is the slide from that that talk. And those are the data from June 17th last year. So we're just 5 days out from an anniversary. And there you can see, for example, and I think you'll remember in the March, April, May, June, we were thinking of the idea of 722 deaths a day and 100,000 deaths as a truly extraordinary and appalling thing. And yet what we you know, here we are with not that dissimilar numbers right now. So I want to make a point, that really clear point. We're not out of this yet, and there's a lot of work to be done to get past it. A couple of quick things about annoying nomenclature. Maybe everybody knows this at this point. The disease is coronavirus disease, COVID-19. That was the designation given to it. And SARS-CoV-2 is actually the virus. So stands for severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2. It's a mouthful, but SARS-CoV-2 is the virus that causes the disease, and this is what we call the disease itself. And another sort of thought here is that COVID-19 is not a binary outcome disease. There's a very strong tendency to think of just two possible outcomes, right? You get it and you survive. And I think a lot of young people are inclined to say, and I don't want to be too preachy, but a lot of young people are saying, well, you know, young people don't die. If I get it, I'll get over it. And that's very likely true. You probably will survive, but there is more than just survival or mortality. Like most things in life, there's a large gray zone in between. And survival is great, but for many, it's just the beginning of a very long road. And life may never look quite the same again. And actually, just last week, I lost the ninth person that I know personally to COVID, who was a 49-year-old neuroscientist who had COVID 8 months ago, at nearly the beginning of the pandemic, and has not been well ever since. And so his death will not be ascribed to COVID, but the reason was this incredibly healthy, athletic person had their health so badly impacted by COVID that he ultimately ended up dying of a heart attack that is absolutely secondary to COVID. And that's why I say we're underestimating the numbers. Asymptomatic disease is also good, but does asymptomatic really mean no deleterious outcomes? And again, we don't really know that at this point. Let's turn to the brain. A big question is, does the coronavirus actually get into the brain? Because you'll all have heard about the blood-brain barrier, the BBB. And we're very lucky. We have this barrier that stops bad stuff getting into our brain. Our brain has a very special set of protections that most of the rest of the organs in the body don't. But it does look very likely like that SARS gets into the brain. And one of the ways actually you'll know about, because you'll all have heard about this sort of this infamous anosmia, losing the sense of smell. And what's that about? Well, the olfactory system, your smell system, is a kind of an amazing system. And you might, again, you may already know this, because it's one of those places where the brain actually pokes down out of the skull into the environment. So there's a thing here, right? This is, if anybody's ever had sort of nasal sinus issues, this is what we're talking about up here in this nasal cavity, where it can be very easy to get a little bit of an infection. And this is where you produce all the stuff when you've got a cold or flu. And it's also where aerosolized virus goes up into this passage. And it turns out that one of the things that's happening here is that we're, folks are getting inflammation of these neurons, these olfactory neurons that poke down to what we call the cribriform plate. The cribriform plate's actually a little bit like a sieve. It's got all these nice little holes, and the neurons poke down through there, and they're essentially sticking their waggly little heads out so that they can sample the chemicals that you're breathing in, so you can smell. And so why are people losing the sense of smell? Because these neurons and the support cells around them were getting infected with the virus and getting inflamed. And so very early on, it became clear that this at least was one way in which the virus could get into the brain. And this is from a 25-year-old radiographer. This is very early in the disease, back in March and April last year. And what you can actually see is this is the brain right above the olfactory bulb there. It's a poor image, but what you can see is this hyper intensity, this brightness here, is actually a signal of the viral infection, because this woman had that anosmia issue and had a very inflamed neural support structure in the cribriform plate. And just another not very good image of it, just showing this is the olfactory bulb all inflamed with virus. It's also, we think about COVID, right? And we think about the lungs and this cytokine storm and proning people and ventilators and all that kind of stuff. And of course, that's the thing that's killing people. But it also turns out that when you do basic neurological investigations in people who show up with COVID, right at disease onset, about 42% of patients have clinically meaningful neurological signs. Confusion, inability to concentrate, headaches, of course, as you all have heard. And by the time folks are hospitalized, fully two-thirds of them will have clinically meaningful neurological signs. And across the entire disease, 4 out of 5 folks with COVID, even after recovery, will have had a major neurological issue. So the disease impacts the brain for sure. And again, a cautionary tale, even young patients, those 50 years or younger, people who are almost certainly going to survive the disease by and large, they're about 7 times more likely to have a stroke as a result of COVID than a similar cohort who just have a severe flu. So when anybody says to you, it's just another flu, tell them about the 7-fold increase in risk of stroke. And that's in young people. In older folks, we see a lot of strokes and a lot of clotting. Here's a slide showing what are called mega karyocytes. These are, I won't get too deep into it, but they're cortical capillaries, where part of the blood supply to the neurons. So these are in the brain. And these mega karyocytes have never been seen in the brain before with respect to any other disease we're aware of. But we see them in post-mortem tissue of people who died of COVID-19. And these are producing platelets and plaques and so on. So if they're there in folks who have succumbed to the disease, they're almost certainly there in people who've recovered from the disease or have had a severe case of the disease. And this is bad news, because these are the kinds of events then that will cause the infamous plaques and tangles that you'll have heard about that we associate with Alzheimer's disease. So there's a yes, people will recover, but now their risk of developing pathological brain processes that might lead to early dementia or more severe dementia than they might otherwise have had when they get older, that's all started when they're young. Bad news. And we're very worried about it. I like to show this. These are our favorite tools in the neurosciences these days. They're called organoids or organelles or spheroids. And what they are is they're little brains in a dish. This comes from stem cell technology, induced pluripotent stem cells that we can turn into neurons and into a bunch of neurons, and it basically ask them, if we get the witch's brew just right, we can get these cells to differentiate into all the cell types that you've heard about in the brain: dopaminergic cells, GABAergic cells, pyramidal neurons, and they self-organize into these little spheroids. And they start to fire and do things. They wire together, they fire together, they organize. Now, this is not a conscious piece of tissue, but it has a lot of the properties of a brain. And this has been a real boon to neuroscientists in recent years. And there's very vigorous research efforts around this, because what it allows us to do is it allows us to bathe these little teeny tiny mini brains. So you can see they're 350 microns in diameter. They're about the size of the eye of a housefly. And you can actually see them in the little dish, if you see them. But we can bathe these in things that we care about, like drugs, like disease pathogens. And in fact, very early on, one of the inventors of the whole organoid methodology, Thomas Hartung and his colleagues, did just that. They put SARS-CoV-2 in organoids. And the question was, will neurons take up the virus? And that wasn't known. And in fact, that's exactly what happened. So you can see here these little strands. This is a mock here. So they've put other viral pathogens in here, but not SARS-CoV-2. And here's SARS-CoV-2. And all that pink stuff, these little tangles in neurons, is the virus inside of neurons in these organoids. Now, the big caveat here is that there's no blood-brain barrier. But I've already shown you that the blood-brain barrier is not impenetrable to SARS-CoV-2. So that's kind of the first part of the talk just to say, SARS can get into the brain, and when it gets in there, it does damage, and it's bad news. And it's a really good idea not to catch SARS if you can help it. And so, of course, you probably know what's coming next. Go get vaccinated as soon as you can. It's in everybody's interest. You do not want this pathogen. It's a really bad pathogen. It wreaks havoc on people. And surviving it does not mean you're out of the woods. That's the key.